But I started researching more recently in what actually happens when it goes really badly wrong. We start turning the Internet of Things against us. And I brought lots and lots and lots of smart devices with me that we have spent quite a bit of time hacking over the last year, stuff we presented around the world. But of course, the only place to start is with this. You know what this is, don't you? Those of you, given it's already come up, know about my Wi-Fi kettle. But I'm not going to go over the same old ground. Hey, there's new stuff here. Don't worry, I'm not going to do that to you. What I want to show you is something that I found very recently, in fact. So let's just see if we can connect to that device, see if it's come up. There you go, there is my kettle. I love you, kettle. You're always so damn reliable and insecure. Quick wrap up before I do get into this talk wholesale, though. Come on, you. There you go. Good. Bit of background behind us. I'm sure some of you have seen me before at various conferences. We're a team of pen testers. We spend a lot of our fun time researching IoT devices. And some of the things you've probably seen us involved in were the theft of Wi-Fi credentials, email credentials from a Samsung smart fridge. You probably saw my Mitsubishi Outlander get hacked to death in the summer. Mitsubishi have now fixed that by disabling Wi-Fi on the vehicle, which means you can't use the mobile app anymore. Get in. Samsung smart tellies that we're listening to, that was our piece. And the latest one that we took to DEF CON and presented at Black Hat as well is about looking at ransomware for some really scary bits and pieces. So anyway, back to the same old new thing. There you go, is my Wi-Fi kettle, which we all know and love. It's become a seminal work, I believe. It's even taught on the GCHQ summer school, which I was quite chuffed about. But I want to show you something new. I was still absolutely blown away when I found this. There we go. So over here, I've got a couple of terminal windows. There we go. So you probably know this bit. I hope this is going to work because I haven't practiced. There you go. Now, you all know there's a telnet interface on there, and the default password you can recover from the APK, or you can recover from all sorts of other sources, is 60s. That's part of the provisioning process. We'll talk about that in a minute. Now, as you probably all remember, if you recover the user's Wi-Fi key, nice and easy. Okay, but that is a bug, a bit of an issue. What we've discovered since then, and so I was playing around with one of these, I actually broke the fourth one of these. So I had to buy a new one off eBay secondhand. So I bought a couple. And I had a bit of a play around. I thought, I wonder if this has been factory reset. The way you factory reset, hold down 65 degrees centigrade until it beeps twice. Take it out, plug it back in. And this is where it's really impressive. I cannot get over how quickly this device reboots itself. So it's been through a power cycle now. Oh, don't you love it? Probably because it's dropped off. I need to reconnect. There you go. Live demos. Let's give that another go. Cool. You are going to work now, aren't you? Yeah, come on. This works so bloody reliably. You're not going to actually balk out on me, are you? That would be... Oh, of course, it's not going to... Let's try that. There you go. All right, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And here's the slightly scary bit. The new thing we found is that the user's Wi-Fi key survives a factory reset. Wow, that is bananas. So you can actually go out and buy these things secondhand. And given that the user who sold it to me on eBay actually included the reply paid label, I know where their house is. I can now go and buy Wi-Fi keys to hack people's houses. Get in. That is just stupid. So please make sure your device doesn't let a user's Wi-Fi key or any other data for that matter survive it. Now, people say to me, okay, this is a one hack at a time, right? I can attack one person's house. It's not an API. I can't go and hack the entire world using a kettle. But once I've got it, I can man the middle of their home network. I can get everything. You know, they probably haven't changed their router admin password if they're stupid enough to buy a kettle, in which case I can go and change their DNS. But it is one kettle at a time. Now, as you probably all know, the manufacturer came back after being kicked into touch by the BBC and said, look, it's actually quite difficult to find these things, but of course it's a Wi-Fi device. It has an SSID. You can use wiggle.net, the war-driving database, to geolocate these devices and find your targets. So hackers can go out, search them, wiggle, find kettles, go and steal your Wi-Fi keys. Simple as that. Since then, though, the manufacturer has released Kettle 2.0, which I showed last year, but we found something new on this one as well. We reverse engineered the protocol. That was really good fun. It was actually a lot more secure. It uses the ESP8266. Didn't use a secure version, didn't offer secure boot, but that was just another story. But what you can do is you can drive past it and send it a raw hex 0C, and the kettle goes into a firmware update loop and dies.
I've killed 300 quid's worth of kettles doing this. No, so you want to know where they are? There's a few of them. You can go and find those. That's actually one of them. It's next to a competitor's office in Manchester. That's another story. There you go. That's the one you can go and kill if you want. Maybe a bit bored of tea by now. What other crazy stuff can we do? Well, I've spent a lot of time looking at smart coffee machines, and this is mine. It's the Dura E8. Costs a fortune. It's nearly £1,100 worth of coffee machine. It does awesome coffee. Can you tell? Absolutely wired most of the time. But the reason I went for this one was not particularly because of the quality of the coffee. It's because it does Bluetooth. You can buy a little Bluetooth module that pops into it that allows you to remote control the coffee machine. You can do some useful stuff like customized coffee recipes. So I like mine dialed up to 11 on caffeine and a full cup of it very, very strong, please. So you can customize your own recipes. You can also tell it to make remotely. So over Bluetooth, great, fantastic. Problem. No pairing security on Bluetooth, and it's always in pairing mode. So anyone can connect a mobile app to the coffee machine and start taking control of it, which is really good fun if one of your colleagues goes to the machine and they wanted an espresso. You can make it really watery. That's good fun, but the real purpose of the mobile app is actually to allow you to monitor its usage, so you know when it's time to buy more coffee beans in a busy office. But in order to do that, it needs to be able to communicate with you by email. So it needs your email address and password so it can mail out using your account. And it stores that, not encrypted in the keychain, but in a SQLite database in plain text. Whoa, okay. And then singly, the most pointless IoT device I've ever met, to pick up on your point about whether we need these devices, is an Espresso Prodigio, which you might have seen in the market. It was out in about 7-8 months ago, and it's a capsule coffee machine, an espresso thing. So fantastic, it's got a mobile app, you can make it make the coffee remotely. But unlike the Dura, which has got a nice big bean hopper, you've actually got to go to an espresso thing and put the capsule in first. What? I was blown away when I saw that. So you've actually not only got to remember to put the cup in and put water in, you've got to put the capsule in it too. But the point I wanted to make about this one is another random one, which is that when you start looking at the mobile app permissions, which has also got full e-commerce functionality, so it'll actually keep track of your capsule stock, which you can screw around with and actually turn the thresholds up to 65,000. That was good fun. The mobile app has also got some bonkers permissions, including the ability to silently make calls from your phone without alerting you. Why does that mobile app have permission to use your phone? It's a bloody coffee machine. It also doesn't do encryption correctly and doesn't store payment details. Crazy. Anyway, I want to move on a bit now. I want to talk a little bit about challenges with pairing. Now, I think what came out from the previous two demos, so the kettle and the coffee machines, is that, you know, it's perfectly possible to do RF communication securely if you follow the guidance. If you actually implement security, if you actually make Bluetooth use a pin rather than making it continuously in pairing mode and no pin at all. Nuts. We're continually seeing this stuff. People throw out RF products on chipsets that support security, but then don't actually implement it. Now, something I've been looking at more recently is the process around provisioning over RF. And this is really, I think, quite a challenge, actually. Now, I brought along BB-8 last year. Right, it takes a bit of a sod to get out. Has anyone got BB-8 for their kids yet for Christmas? He's a fantastic, go full down R&D tax claim on this. Yeah, it's not for me, it's for my son, honest. Anyway, so what got me looking at this was one of the challenges of actually provisioning an IoT device and from the unconfigured state. Now, what you could do is try and protect your communications using six zeros like the kettle does, but hopefully you want to protect that provisioning process in any key exchange in a much more secure way. The reason I brought my little friend BB-8 along is this year's crazy, crazy release, which I absolutely love. It only arrived this morning. I had it in pieces by lunchtime. I still haven't actually managed to get to work yet. But this year's big toy to go with BB-8 is the Force Band. I love this. Absolutely awesome. It is a little device you wear. Okay, got a picture of it there. And you put it on your hand. You can control BB-8 using the Force, otherwise hand gestures. So there's a small accelerometer in there, Bluetooth LE, hooks up to your mobile app as well, and allows you to drive this little guy with gestures. And I cannot wait for Christmas Day. But in the meantime, we've been having a bit of a play around with it because it's got really, really interesting. I took the cover off literally this morning to see what we could do, and that is the inside. And the first thing I loved, it's a custom board, fantastic, by Sphero, really cool. Don't know if you can see on the top there, wow, that's, I think that's the first board I've ever seen with JTAG interfaces marked up. I don't have to buzz them out myself to figure out what does what. Wow. Awesome. You didn't need to do that. You know, you just removed a layer of potential obscurity that makes my life a whole lot easier when I'm reverse engineering it. Now, going through the process of figuring out how the Bluetooth LE process works would be really difficult. Until I discovered this. That is the aerial. You can see it just flicked on there. Now, my plan later this week when I got a few of my colleagues together is to solder a very high-gain antenna on there. The pairing process is this. You start the pairing process on the force band, and all you have to do to take control of it is touch it to the droid. And actually, you just saw there, it actually just went into a pairing mode. There's nothing on the droid to say, put me into a pairing mode. There's no interface on there. There's nothing for you to play with. So the only way you can force it into pairing mode is from this. And they assure security by saying, well, you can only pair if you're physically next to it. Okay, must be there. Except that, with a 20 decibel high gain antenna on there, I can now make that device think I'm next to it when I'm outside. So our big fun plan for our next piece in the press is going to be showing how you can take control of BB-8 from outside someone's house, taking advantage of a weakness in the pairing process. What I really want to do is attach this to a Bluetooth sniper rifle in the shape of a, what they call again? Well, there's swords in lightsaber, there you go. So you can point a lightsaber at BB-8 and turn it to the dark side yet again. But that really picks up on an interesting issue there, because you want to try and do pairing securely, so you think, okay, it's safe, the user must be next door. They're not, because they can amplify their signal. Exactly the same attack as you saw against vehicles. So proximity-based keys, all I have to do is amplify the signal, and then potentially I can make the vehicle think that its keyless entry system is next door, when actually it's in the hacker's pocket down the road. Now, other areas, you might think about having unique keys per device, and this is a big selling toy. It's going to be the big selling toy in the US this Christmas. This is Anki Cosmo. We shipped them in from the States. They're not available over here. And this is how it sets itself up. It has a unique password. Now, one of the challenges you have is doing unique per device passwords, unique keys in the production process is very expensive. Try getting your manufacturer in the Far East to do this for you. They're going to charge you a lot of money, which leads to the temptation to actually try and generate a key using an algorithm on the device. And of course, that exposes itself to reverse engineering. It's not genuinely unique, which leads to some real challenges with provisioning. So if you wanted to share key material, you'd ideally want to encrypt it. But how can you encrypt it if you don't have a source of entropy locally? You're stuffed, aren't you? You haven't got anything on the device that you can assure is truly random, therefore you're exposing it to cracking techniques. Now, there are some sources of entropy you can consider. So an on-chip source, you might think about, say, time since boots, maybe some environmental factors, noise and things that give you a degree of entropy, great. But again, your chipset's got to support it, which adds cost. You can do it at the factory, very expensive way of doing it. One of those I've seen that I actually really like about doing it, and this takes advantage of the fact that your IoT device might not have a user interface, but I've seen it done and suggested, assure proximity of the device by the device being close, but to defeat the concept of someone using signal amplification, have something you push on the device or change on the device to put the device itself into a pairing mode. Then you know the consumer is with the device, it's the consumer that's initiated the pairing, and you can exchange the keys safely. Really worth thinking about that. Very difficult when you don't have a UI, but if you think about certain modes, maybe pick them up and put them up and down three times into the charging container, not a bad way of getting the device to go, yeah, now I'm in pairing mode, rather than permanently being in pairing mode. Now, I don't know if any of you saw, I've been on the TV twice in 2 days. I don't know quite how that happened, but I'm going to go back, because you'll all know about my swearing kid's dog, because I've been talking about her for years, but something changed this morning, something big. I've been banging on about the fact that I think we need some litigation out there in order to get IoT manufacturers and device manufacturers like this to actually start taking security a bit more seriously. And just this morning, we saw the European Consumer Organization starting with the Norwegian one, I believe it's also happened in the US as well this morning, are taking action. They filed an official complaint against the manufacturer of the toy, Vivid Toys, for child privacy issues. Fantastic. About bloody time too. This is the only way we're going to get manufacturers of cheap IoT gear to actually start taking security just a little bit more seriously. Bring it on. We need plenty more of this, please. Next crazy place I'm going to go. I get asked all the time, was asked loads about this little thing. You know what it is? It's a dot. Amazon Echo Dot. Great. I had one of these on the first day they were released over here. And we've been looking at the security of these for a little while and found it really interesting because, do you know what? Amazon have really thought about it. I was expecting to be all over it, I'll be honest with you, and we got a bit stuck. They've really thought about it. They've really thought about the implementation. They thought about security. It's good. Not perfect, but it's good. But what we have noticed is a lot of organizations starting to integrate with these. And one we found was a smart door lock. Again, we had to ship it in from the USA. We had some issues. We had to spoof our IP address to be in the US so it actually let us download the recipe we needed. A smart door lock. It's from a company called August. Brilliant. Fantastic. I thought, yeah, so you can lock the door by talking to it. Great. These things are amazingly sensitive. They can hear you whispering from across the other side of the room when there's noise. So, of course, if it's inside the house and I'm outside the window, I'm going to shout, unlock door. And the door lock pops. That's silly. That's not a security issue, but it's silly. And if you think that's not mad, this is another one. So you might remember we looked at BMW's connected drive 2.5 years ago and found a bunch of security issues within the connected vehicle mobile app. Found the ways you could basically enumerate your way into provisioning someone's application on your phone, find it, unlock the car, get in, you've got access to the diagnostics port. Great, it's all over. BMW have just announced integration of the connected drive with the Amazon Echo. Lock or unlock your BMW with your voice. Whoa, so your car's in the driveway, your Echo's inside the house, I go outside your window, unlock BMW, thank you very much. That saved me a load of trouble. Other crazy stuff. Now, the big game changer for me, which I explained last year when I was here, is the fact you're putting the source code of your mobile application into the hands of the hacker. You're giving them the mobile apps. I can reverse engineer it, I can work out how your device communicates. But nowadays, the next big game changer you're doing is putting a hardware in the hands of the hacker, and that's my Jura, the coffee machine. And what we've done there is we've popped out the Bluetooth module, top left there, and we've popped in some logic probes, and we're now looking at that, analyzing the traces. We've discovered a binary protocol, and we're going through the process of reverse engineering that. Once I've captured your firmware, it's highly likely I'll find flaws in it. I'll find bugs in it. I can modify your firmware, push it out to devices, and start doing fun stuff. What I really want to do is run Doom on the LCD there, but we're working on that. But that reinforces a really important point about your firmware security. You absolutely must sign your firmware, and you must check that signature at boot time. Otherwise, it could be anybody's firmware. Check your firmware, sign it, protect it, and don't put anything silly in there. Don't put static credentials in there. Another really interesting attack is firmware rollback. Now, when we're working on automotive systems, we're starting to find signed code running on ECUs nowadays. But during the calibration processes for these vehicles, you'll typically find firmware versions that allow calibration of the vehicle. They're typically the ones used by service centers or by when they're first setting up the vehicle and optimizing its performance and its handling. You can often find you can roll back to an earlier signed version of the firmware. You can find them out there with all the calibration protocols enabled. So everything's open. I can do what I want. I can make it go to 11 or whatever I want it to do. So be careful about firmware rollback as well. This is a great example. This is the Fitbit Aria scales. We did them a couple of years ago. Fitbit were a really cool vendor, by the way. They interacted really well with us. But the problem we found is once you whip the back off the scales, you can start getting user data out of various IO ports. So the UART port we managed to get personal user data from. The SPI bus we managed to get the user's Wi-Fi pre-shared key from. Now, yeah, the hack was interesting, but the issue was that those IO ports should not have been enabled in production devices. Why put a diagnostic port, why leave it enabled in a cheap IoT device? If this goes wrong and the customer calls up with a problem, are you going to send an engineer? No, you're going to send them a new one. So why leave diagnostic ports available in live production devices? These should be fused out. Nuts. That's just making it really, really easy for us. Whether it's JTAG, UART, SPI, whatever. They should be frozen out. Next place I want to go is this is what we talked about in Vegas in the summer, was the idea of IoT ransomware. You probably remember that we got a smart stat. This is Avenstar. At the time when we presented it at Black Hat, we hadn't successfully disclosed it, so we'd actually taped over the hiss, although the manufacturer recognized it. Oops. And what we were looking at is the concept. People had talked about the idea of ransomware, and every talk I went to, It was just theoretical. So I thought, bollocks to this, we're going to have a go. And we went out and we started researching various potential devices. US devices tend to be a bit more functional, had a nice interactive screen, that's just rebooted, great. First place you go, start researching on the FCC because it's got an RF chipset on there, it needs to be accredited. So you can get most of what you need for the device without buying it. So we discovered after a few minutes, we've got chipset diagrams, great. Nice module on there, see the triacs running, everything we need, great. That's a good device, we can identify that one, we're going to go for it. Initially, we're looking for a JTAG header. Turned out not to be one, which is a bit of a shame. We're a bit gutted about that, until we discovered that actually you can configure the device using an SD card. This is quite fiddly on screen to set up a complicated heating and cooling schedule. So they make it easy. There's an Adobe Air app, which you can use to write a schedule onto an SD card and then pop that in there. Great, nice and easy. But except it was an enormous Air app. It was approaching a gigabyte in size. It was bonkers. Until we realized they actually included the firmware in the app. Brilliant. So we didn't even need to extract it from the device, we just downloaded it. Awesome. We started messing around with it. One great big binary seemed to do everything. If you want to reverse engineer, something like Binwalk's a great place. We got lucky this time and we got a Linux file system. Great, so we're in. We now know how the device is working. As we started looking through it, this is a really simplified version of what we do. What we discovered, they weren't validating input correctly. Just like with the web app, firmware is vulnerable to injection attacks as well. In this case, we found the copy command, where you copy a desktop wallpaper, a photograph, to make it look a bit more friendly, and discovered that that input was not correctly validated. So all we had to do was upload a rogue image, and we could start taking control of the device. You can see there, we've now got ransomware running. It's locked. You can't do... Oh, actually, you have unlocked it. That's another story. But what I want to reinforce here is, my experience is that firmware developers don't realize their code can be extracted. I don't think this particular developer realized anyone, even his colleagues, would read their code. Here's a great example. So the way it handles a balked SSL connection, it's the SSL shit status. Gets better, there is a screen saver that wipes between various background images, and that's called the son of a bitch mode. These guys didn't think their code was going to be read, did they? So in order to take control of it, we locked it using an existing kiddie safe pin. We enrolled the pin every 30 seconds so the user was never going to guess it, controlled it remotely over IRC, and then changed this backdrop image to some ransomware. The only thing we got wrong was the fact that we got our Bitcoin exchange rate wrong, and we held it to ransom for about $500. It's a $200 thermostat. Oops. But think about it. If someone's at home on a cold day like last night, and the thermostat locks out, and you say you can't have control back, you're locked out, would you give it some money? I don't know about you, I'd rip it off the wall. In fact, I wouldn't even have one of these things in my house. But people are out there putting in smart thermostats en masse into their houses and not thinking about the consequences. You can also cause some other issues as well. Switching and contactors on and off will eventually damage stuff. Got it. So finally, I want to talk about weapons. Now, you're probably familiar with DVR issues. This is something we wrote back in February. About the MV-powered DVR, we noticed it was basically remotely compromisable. Discovered that was the most read blog on our website recently. We weren't quite sure why, until we started seeing the incidents behind Mirai, which I'm sure you all know about. The slightly scary bit about Mirai is it's nothing to do with printers, voice over IP phones, and routers and other things. It is all about DVRs. This is the list that Brian Krebs put up, which attributes the default credentials found in the Mirai source code to a device. And a lot of them were wrong. We went out and bought a shed load of DVRs. This one is a QVIS. Its default password is ZLXX full stop. So the device it attributes to is not a two-way speaker. We've since done it, we found a bunch of others. We have a Yale, which default password is EC53511. What really scared me about the Yale device is it also integrates with your home alarm system. So you could potentially compromise the DVR using the default credentials and then disable your house alarm. Get in. So it's all about DVRs. So all the stuff you saw about other devices, no, Mirai is DVRs, that's all it is. There are some CCTV cameras that are vulnerable to it, but that's because they've got embedded DVR code in them. It's the DVR helper process that causes the problem. Other scary, scary things. Everyone familiar with the TalkTalk bug? Yeah, this has evolved overnight. The issue is you're allowed to use TR69. That's basically a WAN management protocol for looking after the ISP to look after the customer router. You should not be publishing TR64 to the internet. That is the LAN management interface. So what's happened in this case, I think it's a result of a bug in the Zyxel ROM pager, TR64 has been published outbound. You can do all sorts of scary things with that. And on Saturday morning, we saw a request on our honeypot for this, get security keys. Now, you're probably familiar with the outages that hit the press sort of Tuesday, Wednesday last week. That hit our honeypot. Get security keys recovers the user's Wi-Fi key. So we're seeing people with compromised routers. The reason TalkTalk's advice was to hit the reset button was because actually once it's been compromised with TR64, you can't push a new firmware with TR69. So it's forcing the user to manually reset. And if you actually look at the reset process, the user retriggers it. That fixes the TR64 issue and resets the Wi-Fi key back to the default on the back of the router. But what do we know about Joe Public? They never changed them from the default in the first place. So whilst the TR64 bug has been patched, the Wi-Fi keys that were exposed before are just the same as the Wi-Fi keys that are exposed now. Now, we've got evidence to suggest that over 57,000 sets of users' Wi-Fi keys for TalkTalk customers were exposed. We've seen over 100,000 keys exposed in the UK, and that's just here. There are over 50 different router types that are vulnerable to the TR64 bug, and as far as we're aware, only Aircom, the Irish ISP, TalkTalk and one other had actually actively been out and fixed the TR64 bug. This is really nasty stuff. We're starting to see requests to take over routers. So an ACS attack basically changes the management from one ISP to another, so a rogue one, so you can take it over. If you do see an ACS change, that router's lost to the ISP. There's nothing they can do to recover it other than replace it. There's other issues. We've seen potential remote code execution in these routers. You can actually use TR64 to enable SSH. The SSH key is the user's Wi-Fi key. Brilliant. So you can actually do remote code execution. You can also change things like DNS as well. It is nuts. Anyway, the last place I want to leave you is back to my thermostat. These things switch a lot of power, particularly in the USA and Canada, where more power tends to be done for AC and electrical heating. Got a lot of interesting control of these things. We've found other thermostat brands with remote code execution on, around 500,000 already. You can start switching on and off people's electricity demand concurrently. So all you do is wait until the grid capacity is close to demand, and you switch on 500,000 thermostats at the same time. It doesn't work so well in the UK because we're gas powered mostly over here. But if you go to tech countries where there's far more use of air conditioning, which is electrically powered, or electrically powered heating, you can create massive power spikes. Now, the grid's quite good at coping with on. It's not very good with coping with on-off, and it's very bad at coping with on-off-on again. I think we're going to start seeing in the near future some black start events. That's where we start knocking out enough of the grid to stop things functioning for a while. When the east coast of the US goes offline, that's a black start. And the reason being is power stations need power to get themselves going. So we have four power stations in the UK that have got black start capacity, and that's why it takes a while to get going. One starts the other, starts the other, starts the other. Everything's back to normal, wait for capacity to go up, bang, knock it offline again. Anyway, that's the scary bit. I will just advise, leave you with this. The attack surface for us with IoT is enormous. I think there's fantastic opportunities. I think there's fantastic and scary breach potential as well with all this. Guidance, I think the ITSF does some amazing work. I cannot recommend enough the guidance that they're publishing. I think OWASP for developing your web apps, your mobile apps, and your APIs is really good. I think it's critical that you specify security and security standards in your development contracts. And finally, test it, look at it. Make sure it's actually secure rather than just hoping. A few questions you could ask, really simple things we see go wrong all the time. SSL certificate pinning is often missed out. People don't think about what information is on the IoT device itself. They don't think about firmware validation. And they don't think about those devices being sold on secondhand. Anyway, one last thing I will leave you with is please, please, please create a security at email address that researchers like me and others out there, if they find a security bug, can send you and say, look, we found some stuff. And do something about it. I tweet about this more than once a day. I absolutely love this space. It's so rewarding. And I get to play with toys too. Thank you.